So, sir, we'll start with the first question, which is for you. Sir, you come from a long line of poets. Your father, Jaan Nisar Akhtar Saab, was a great poet, and so was your grandfather. So a student from GIIS Tokyo asks, was being a poet something you were born into, or was it a conscious choice you made?
I wonder how much such talents travel through genes. I don't know, because whether this talent is acquired or it is inborn, I'm not very clear about it. But yes, I suppose if not the genes, the immediate environment, the atmosphere does help you in cultivating or developing certain capabilities, certain talent. Or maybe to some extent one is born also with certain inclination. If I was born with this inclination, it's not a surprise because my last seven generations were poets and writers. So if this is possible, that this can travel through genes, I'm sure it must have. Because seven generations can't waste time. After saying this, I'll say that as a matter of fact, I could have been a poet at a very early age. I was interested in poetry. The poetry was all around my parents, then my maternal uncle, my paternal uncle, all of them were known poets. Then their friends were poets and writers and so on. So by the time I was 12, I remembered hundreds of couplets, and by the time I was 15 or 16, thousands of couplets. Even today, because of that time, I think I can recite other people's poetry for a few hours without looking at a piece of paper. I knew that I can write lines in meter and in rhyme and so on, but somehow I did not have the courage or the inclination to do it. There may be two reasons. One, because I was at a very early age, I had come to know what is good poetry, and that was rather intimidating. If you know what is good, then perhaps you lose that courage that only the ignorant can have. On the other side, you know, when everybody in your family, every elder is doing the same thing, you feel that if I'll do that, then I'll be joining the bandwagon. I won't be a rebel, I'm accepting the tradition or the status quo. So perhaps that was also that in my teenage, that rebellion attitude stopped me from writing. But ultimately, I suppose it had to happen sooner or later. I started writing poetry when I was perhaps 30, 31. I mean, generally people stop writing poetry at that age.
But then you met me at that time, and that's why the poetry started.
I think that's really true, ma'am, because your family has been a real treasure for India, and we really respect and honor your work. Thank you, sir.
Ma'am, our next question is to you from GIIS Abu Dhabi. After your performances in movies like Earth and Fire, you have really cemented yourself as an actress who challenges society by being different. Your rise to fame wasn't a smooth one, and you faced a lot of negativity and criticism. How did you manage to deal with such backlash at a very early stage in your career, and what drove you to continue accepting such roles?
Well, I grew up in a family that believed art should be used as an instrument for social change. My father was a member of the Communist Party, he was a poet, my mother's an actress, and I grew up in a very liberal atmosphere where speaking your mind was encouraged. And in fact, it's not true that I was given a hard deal. In fact, I was given a lot of respect. Because I started with parallel cinema that really opened up the doors for another kind of Indian cinema. And it was much later, as late as when I did a film called Fire, that the controversy started. And I'm not interested in controversy per se, but if I want to say something very strongly, then I'm willing to risk the controversy. So as a person, I've always been raised to believe that we should try and understand the other instead of rejecting the other. So I felt that if you worked in fire and then you could create some kind of empathy for the two women, then you could extend that empathy to the other religion, the other race, the other country, etc. And so I remember that when I worked, when I decided to do the film, I asked Javed and I said, what should I do about it? And he said, well, if you're convinced that this will be done artistically and that you want to do it, go ahead. So it's on the power of your conviction that you have to go ahead and do it. But whenever you try to get past the status quo, whenever you try to upset the apple cart, you have to be prepared for the fact that since you are taking, see, it's very safe. You can be very safe. You can take positions where you ruffle no feathers and people will say how beautiful and wonderful you are and you'll get great appreciation. But do you want from the bottom of your heart to raise the level of the debate, to take it to where you believe constitutionally you have been given? And so when you, when you're prepared to shake the waters, then you have to be ready to accept that there will be some backlash. But your biggest strength comes from your own belief and from the support system around you. Because I have grown up in a family where I'm surrounded by Javed, who has the same worldview as me, my brother, my sister-in-law, my parents, all of that. So whenever I have felt attacked, I felt this concentric circle of very close people who carry me on and say that, go ahead. And I think I also get my strength from there.
Ma'am, your courage is truly awe-inspiring to all of us.
You want to add to it?
We'll move on to the next question. Shabana ma'am and Akhtar saab, you have both served as members of the Indian Parliament. And during your political term, you have interacted with many people from various walks of life. So as Indians and as leaders in your respective fields, what do you think is the biggest strength of the Indian people? And what do you identify as the biggest weakness?
Well, I think the biggest strength as people or as a nation. As a nation, our biggest strength is our democracy. We should be thankful to our seniors, the old elder generation, the past generation, that has given us this fabulous, exceptional constitution. It is one of the, being a student of politics, I can say it is one of the finest constitutions in the world. And not only that, that we have a constitution, over the years, democracy has really taken deep roots in Indian soil. Today, an average Indian cannot think of a society which is not democratic. I mean, he'll be horrified thinking about it. So this is a democracy is our biggest strength, in a way. As people, a bigger strength is the tolerance. Bigger strength is accepting, because that has been our culture since millennia, that we accept that there are people who are different, there are people who speak different languages, there are different people who speak, have different religions, people with different traditions, to people with different ethos, different culture, different music, and so on and so forth. To an extent, let me tell you, as far as the music is concerned, India is the only country in the world that has two complete disciplines of classical music which are different. One is Hindustani, another is Karnataka. The only country. If you see a folk music from one end to another, is different, and every time you will find something fresh, something different, and we accept the difference, whether it's music or cuisine or clothes or language or traditions or religion. this is our biggest strength. And that makes India, India. That's what I feel.
Thank you, sir. And speaking of tolerance, I think my friend has a question relating to that.
So, Shabana ma'am, Akhtar saab, after the Supreme Court placed a ban on triple talaq, you both expressed your full support for it. You even called it a victory for brave Muslim women. So ma'am, our friends in GIIS would like to know what, according to you, is the role and responsibility of artists such as your stature to express their opinion and help change society and its thinking in order to guide pioneers like us?
Well, I've already partially answered that question because I came from a background where I was, where I experienced that art should be used as an instrument for social change, and speaking out one's mind was something that was encouraged. It came quite naturally that one would do that. I do think that in a country like India, where artists are given so much love and so much respect, it becomes incumbent on them to also take up positions that are the good fight, because people listen to them. And so you encourage people on the right values that you believe in. Because you see, art, you can be a good artist only if your resource base is life itself. You cannot treat your art separately. All right, my art is 9 to 6, I will do this job, and then I'll come back to being the kind of person I am. Some of the residue of what you have been playing, a person against social injustice, a person standing up for rights, for equality, that will also translate into your personal life. And that then becomes very important, I think, for artists to fight the good fight, to put yourself out there and to say that, because the whole purpose of art is to create a climate of sensitivity in which it is possible for change to occur. So for me, it's a given. I do not say that every single artist should do that, but given the kind of background that I come from, the worldview that we have followed, it's just a given.
Ma'am, I think it takes back to, like you said, that in India, artists like yourself are given so much love and so much respect. Your words really carry weight for majority of the Indian public. So do you think it's important that every celebrity and artist continue to talk about such important worldviews, even if it's a considered a taboo in society?
Let me answer this question first. As a matter of fact, I mean, there is a line in somebody's poem, "Jo baat bahut pehle karni thi, ab ki hai." Actually, this triple talaq should not have been there in right from the beginning in our constitution. The constitution should not have given this room for such kind of practices. But anyway, it happened. I'm happy that now it has been, at least Supreme Court has banned it. But I suppose this is the first step in the right direction. We have a long way to go. I have been very, very vocal about opposing such kind of traditions since last 20, 25 years. And I had a small group of secular, progressive people who would go to different, we would go to different cities, organize meetings, call people, particularly the Muslims in that area, and tell them what is wrong with it, and this so-called Muslim personal law, why it is not desirable, and so on and so forth. And I'm so happy that ultimately it has happened. But the fact is that in India, we have a Hindu court bill, which is for Hindus, then Christian personal law, then Parsi personal law, then Muslim personal law, and so on and so forth. And within Hindu community, there are all two sets of laws and so on. I don't know in a country which has such variation of cultures and subcultures and traditions, whether a uniform civil code will be feasible or not. If it is feasible, wonderful. But if it is not, and we feel that there are different tribes that have different traditions, in South you have different traditions and acceptance, and the North there is something different in South, girl can marry her maternal uncle. In the north, it will be almost incest, and so on and so forth. This was tradition. Nothing is wrong and nothing is right about it. The acceptance of generation. If it is not possible, then one thing has to be very clear, that if any personal law has any conflict with the Constitution of India, then the Constitution of India will prevail. The personal law cannot be an exception. That is not possible. Any personal law, if it is in conflict, we have certain rights as citizens of India. Any right that is given to a woman or a man by the Constitution of India, no religion should have the right to take it away. That should be the key. This is the minimum. If we can achieve uniform civil code or some common civil code, wonderful. If we can't, because of so many problems and so many differences, then this is the touchstone. This has to be there. And let me tell you that all these personal laws, including Hindu code bill, they are extremely unfair. That's why I'm saying that this is the first step towards right direction. A lot has to be done, a lot. I have studied that because this was something which was very disturbing to me for years. And I have spoken about it, and I've written about it, because this is something that we have to get rid of.
You know, I want to add to an earlier question that you asked. I really think India's greatest strength is her pluralism and her diversity. The fact that it's a multicultural, multilingual, multicaste, multilingual society is its greatest strength. But at the moment, like there is all over the world, there is an attack on this pluralism, and I think we need to protect it. And I do want to seize every opportunity that I get to emphasize that the fight is not between one religion or another. So it is not a fight between the Hindu and the Muslim, as it is being posited. It's not a fight between the Christian and the Muslim, as is being posited. It's a fight between ideologies. So what we have to really understand is that the fight is the Hindu-Muslim-Christian-liberal on the same side against the bigoted Hindu-Muslim-Christian on the other. So the fight is not between the religion, the fight is between ideologies. And today, as citizens of the world, we have to know that it is not just tolerance that we demand acceptance, because diversity of any small minority also is something that we need to respect and give opportunity to.
Ma'am, sir, I think we couldn't agree more. We really agree that we have a long way to go and we're still in the process. But sir, moving on, the next question is for both of you. So we have a young audience of classes 7 and 8 watching us. And for their benefit, could you share as to what, according to you, is success? What do you think defines success? Everyone has a different definition. So as pioneers, as they move forward in their life, how would you give them a piece of your advice?
I think you have said very rightly that everybody has her own or his own definition of success. Ultimately, again, I'll say what I have said, that it is illusionary. It is a kind of a mirage, because whenever you achieve something, whether it is notional or real or material or intellectual or intangible, whatever, when you achieve it, you realize that this is not the end of the world. And you realize that it is not giving you such happiness that you thought that you will get. Because again, you want to move ahead. So as long as you are making goals, achieving them, feeling nice about it, but then you make another goal, you don't give up there. You don't think that this is the end. Then, actually, in a way, it is a paradox. Paradox, one, that on one hand, you should have certain level of satisfaction and thankfulness and gratitude towards life, that life has given you so much and life has been kind to you. On the other side, there has to be a desire, a quest for better, more. And, ostensibly, they are not compatible. But the fact is that you have to make them compatible. And that is how you will live. Happiness of pursuit and happiness of immediate environment. Both of them are needed. And if you can acquire that, then you are a successful person.
Ma'am, sir, although I would love to continue talking to you about your worldview and opinion, we now have a question from GIIS Kuala Lumpur, and they ask, Shabana ma'am, you normally immerse yourself into roles and get highly involved in it. That has made us love every single one of the characters that you have played. When you do plan for a new role, how do you come out of your previous mindset in order to adapt to the new character and the new background that's created?
Well, I'm a professionally trained actor, and that has helped me to a great extent, because there is also a craft. There is a truth and there is a craft, and you have to take on the challenge of inhabiting another world. So you can start in different ways. Sometimes from the outside in, sometimes you think about how the character is going to look, how the character is going to walk, how the character is going to speak. Sometimes you delve deep into the resources of the character's truth, of what kind of person that character is, and from there the externals can come out. But it only happens through a lot of hard work. After being in the movie industry for 40 years, I am a very hard-working actor. I do not take anything for granted. And I approach every single role that I do like as if I'm doing it for the first time. And the first day when I go on the sets, I'm really, really nervous, let me tell you that.
Thank you, ma'am. Think Likhit, you have a question?
Javed sir, for people for whom literature and poetry plays such an important role in their lives, you have really cemented yourself as one among the nation's greatest. So my friend from GIIS Surat has a question for you, more of a request. He requests you to share a few lines from your favorite poem or song, and why these lines are so special for you.
I'm not trying to sound modest. As a matter of fact, whatever I have written, I never think in terms of that is my favorite poem. Because whatever is done, now it is for others to decide whether it is good or bad. I should think of those poems that I have not written and concentrate on that work that I have not done, instead of feeling happy about what I have already done. Nevertheless, since you have asked me to recite some poems, I will.
So something maybe which is close to your heart.
Everything that I have written was close to my heart. That's why I have written.
Sir, any words of yours will inspire us. So anything which you say will be close to your heart. So anything will do.
I try to write, and I believe in writing in as simple language as possible, because ultimately languages are meant for communication. And if they fail to communicate, they may do anything. They are not doing their basic job. So I try to keep my language as transparent as possible. But then what happens if you are taking a subject which is not very familiar, which is not discussed every day? Then that subject will definitely bring certain words which are not heard every day. So there are few words which are perhaps not that familiar for everybody. I'll translate those words, but then you'll know what I'm talking about. Although the title of this poem is Meri Dua Hai. Now, dua is prarthana or praying. Being an atheist, I don't believe in dua or any kind of prayer. But here I have used this word prayer in the sense of wish. Khala means space, outer space. Jazeera means island. Khala ke gehre samandaron mein agar kahin koi hai jazeera jahan koi saans le raha hai, jahan koi dil dhadak raha hai, jahan zehanat ne, intelligence ne ilm ka jam pee liya hai. Intelligence has consumed knowledge. Khala ke gehre samandaron mein agar kahin koi hai jazeera jahan koi saans le raha hai, jahan koi dil dhadak raha hai, jahan zehanat ne ilm ka jam pee liya hai, jahan ke baasi ab apni dharti ke sahilon se utarne ko hai apne beede, talash karne koi jazeera jahan koi saans le raha hai, jahan koi dil dhadak raha hai. Meri dua hai, meri dua hai ki us jazeere ke rehne walon ke jism ke rang is jazeere pe rehne walon ke jism ke jitne rang hain unse mukhtalif, different. Mukhtalif means different. Meri dua hai ki us jazeere ke rehne walon ke jism ka rang is jazeere ke rehne walon ke jism ke jitne rang hain unse mukhtalif. Badan ki hayat, the form of body, badan ki hayat bhi mukhtalif ho aur shakl o surat bhi mukhtalif ho. Meri dua hai agar unka bhi koi mazhab to is jazeere ke mazhabon se wo mukhtalif ho. Meri dua hai ki is jazeere ki sab zabanon se mukhtalif ho zaban unki. Meri dua hai ki us jazeere ke rehne wale khalai beede mein is jazeere tak aaye, hum unke mezban ho. We play host to them. Those extraterrestrials should come to this planet. Wo humko hairat se dekhte ho, wo paas aakar hame isharon se ye bataye ki unse hum itne mukhtalif hain ki unko lagta hai is jazeere ke rehne wale sab ek se hain. Meri dua hai ki is jazeere ke rehne wale us ajnabi nasl ke kahe ka yaqeen kar le.
That was amazing, sir. Thank you for this absolute privilege of listening to you share some lines. I will cherish this moment for a long time to come. What do you say, GIIS student? Can you wave out to us? Can we have a huge round of applause to Mr. Javed Akhtar, Ms. Shabana Azmi?
I thank you, Shabana ma'am and Akhtar saab, on behalf of everyone here today, for giving us the opportunity to listen to veteran artists like you. And indeed, sir, if I may take the liberty to quote your grandfather, lamha lamha kisi jadu ka fasana hoga.
And indeed, ma'am, the progressive, the unconventional, the encouraging themes of your films motivate us, the youth, and especially young girls like me, to move forward, get inspired, and just conquer the world. Thank you so much for inspiring us.